Good evening, everyone. So today here we all are to discuss about mucormycosis, a rare infection which is now an epidemic. Experts as of Thursday have reported a number of cases of 7,251 of mucormycosis, and the fatality rate associated with this disease is 54%. So we are facing an epidemic in the middle of a pandemic situation. So in such a situation, to spread a true awareness and knowledge among dental students and clinicians, Focus MDS and DentoWoman have collaboratively organized this webinar. Focus is an educational institute offering complete classroom coaching and online training for postgraduate aspirants in the field of dentistry. And DentoWoman is an informative YouTube channel for dental students and NEET MDS aspirants. In the span of less than a year, we are a family of more than 10,000. If you are hearing this word, DentoWoman, for the first time, then you are just a step away. Go to the YouTube, search for DentoWoman, and you are there. Well, today for this webinar, we have two amazing speakers with us. So first, I would like to introduce Dr. Jerry Mammen. Sir has done his BDS from Christian Dental College, CMC Ludhiana. Post BDS, he worked as a junior resident in Christian Dental College for 2 years, after which he worked as an international lecturer in University of Technology, Kingston, Jamaica for a year. In 2012, he was ranked first in CDC for post-graduation qualifying exam and ranked 169 in All India Entrance Exam. Sir joined for MDS in Periodontics in Government Dental College, Calicut, and post PG worked as an assistant professor in Government Dental College, Trichur. He has been part of Focus Teaching Institute from its inception and has been teaching two non-clinical subjects and periodontology as well. So it will be an honor and pride to hear about this from you, Dr. Jerry.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction. So we will directly move on to the topic. So am I audible and clear to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible and clear to everybody?
Everything is good. You may go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. So the topic, like we discussed, is mucormycosis. And today we will see some of the most important points about mucormycosis. I will be discussing about the pathogenesis, the occurrence, and different types of mucormycosis. And Dr. Pravesh will be then continuing with the diagnosis and the treatment plan of it. Okay, to start off, mucormycosis is a serious but rare, relentless, destructive fungal infection caused by a group of molds called as mucormycetes. Okay, so it was earlier called as zygomycosis. Okay. But now biology has been changed and now it is referred to as mucormycosis. Now, moving on, we will just see the basic classification of mucormycosis, how it is classified under what it is, so that you get a basic idea before even you move on to the pathology and everything. Okay. So it is classified under fungi in kingdom. It is classified under fungi. And then in the phylum, it is classified as glomeromycota. Okay. And in the subphylum, it is classified as mucoromycotina. Okay. So it's a fungi. In the phylum, glomeromycota. In the subphylum, mucoromycotina. Now, there are different species that are classified under or identified under this mucoromycotina. Okay, all of them are associated with different types of lesions in mucormycosis. But the most important one or the most prevalent one nowadays is your rhizopus or rhizae. Okay, so this is the most prominent one which we come across for, that causes mucormycosis. Okay, now moving on to the risk factors. So which all patients are prone to or at more risk in developing mucormycosis? Okay, so we will see which are those risk factors. The most important one is your diabetes mellitus. Okay, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus is actually now put as a number one risk factor for mucormycosis. And in those patients of diabetes mellitus who develop diabetic ketoacidosis are at a much higher risk. Okay, so that is your first factor, risk factor. The second one is hematological malignancies, especially your leukemias and your lymphomas. They are also associated with mucormycosis. Those patients who have leukemias and lymphomas are more prone to develop mucormycosis. Why? Because all these patients tend to develop this condition, that is your neutropenia. Neutropenia is nothing but decrease in the number of your neutrophils. So why is it so significant? Why is neutropenia so significant in mucormycosis? The answer is very simple. The first line of defense against mucormycosis is brought about by these neutrophils. These neutrophils are your first line of defense against your mucormycosis. Okay, they are the ones that attack the spores, and they are the ones that attack the hyphae. Once these spores germinate, they are the ones that attack these hyphae and destroy them. So if their count decreases, indirectly or directly, they are affecting the role of your immune system in controlling the fungi in your body or to eliminating the fungi in your body. Okay, so that is why neutropenia is very significant. Okay, then what are the other factors? You have patients who are on prolonged or long-term corticosteroid treatment, patients who had severe burns, immunodeficiency patient, organ transplant and stem cell transplant patients, and iron overload. Okay, hemochromatosis. So patients, again, iron overload is very, very important because, again, iron favors the growth of this fungal hyphae. Okay, as we come to the pathogenesis, we'll see. But again, the point here, why hemochromatosis or why iron load overload is significant is because it will aid in the growth of the fungal hyphae. So actually, it will, if your body or your blood serum has higher levels of iron, it will actually help the fungi to grow at a much faster rate. Okay, so I hope that is clear. Now moving on to the occurrence of the disease. Mostly it is present in your soil and in decomposing tissues. That is where you will find this fungi. Okay, and the most important point is it has the ability to produce spores. Why this is significant is because these spores are the ones which gain entry into either your nasal cavity, your sinus, or into your gastrointestinal tract. Okay, it can be either by inhalation, ingestion, or even inoculation into your skin through some cut or some burns. Okay, and once these spores gain entry, when the environment is favorable, they will start to germinate into the hyphae. So spores, very, very important. And it can cause different lesions in different sites in our body. Now we will see what is the method of transmission. Like I said, inhalation of the spores, inoculation into your skin through any cuts, burns or anything, or ingestion of the spores from the environment through some food items. Okay, so that is how the fungus gain entry into your body. Now the question is it contagious? Does it spread from one patient to another? The answer is no. Mucormycosis can't spread between people or between people and animal. Okay, so only way is you inhale it or you ingest it or you get it inoculated into your skin. Now moving on to the pathogenesis. So now we will see how mucormycosis is gaining entry into your body and how it is affecting your systems or how it is causing damage and finally death in almost 50%. Mortality is almost 50%. Okay, so let's see how does it start. So like we studied, in the environment, in decomposing tissues, in your soil, there are spores. These spores you inhale into your body. Either it will stay inside your nasal cavity, inside your sinus, or it will move into your lungs. Okay, or in your skin, it can get inoculated by some penetrating injury. Okay, so the spores, now the first thing that has happened here is that the spores has gained entry into your body. Now, remember this, any foreign object that goes into your body, immediately your body will recognize it and it will start reacting against it. Okay, it will start reacting against it. How does your body defend? It is by causing or by starting inflammation in your body. That means your innate immune response start coming. Okay, it's audible. Okay, I'm getting messages that it is not audible. Okay, so I hope it is clear. Okay, so as soon as these pores gain entry into your body will show inflammatory response. Why inflammatory response? It's a method of defense. Now, once there's inflammation, we know that the first cells to come to these sites are your neutrophils, PMNs, and your macrophages. What is their role? Their role is to come phagocytose these cells or these pores and remove them from your body so that it does not cause further damage. So your macrophages and your neutrophil, they will start phagocytosing the spores that have come into your body. But now in patients with those risk factors that we are talking about, patients who are on glucocorticoids or patients who have neutropenia, will this happen? No, this will be hampered because there are enough neutrophils to go and attack these spores, or the neutrophils are not capable of removing them from our body. So then what happens? As the environment improves, this spores will germinate into the fungi. It will germinate into the fungi. That means it will start producing fungal hyphae. It will start producing fungal hyphae. Okay. Now, again, at this point, it is again your body's immune cells' duty to come again and attack these fungal hyphae. Again, these are foreign bodies. Again, it is recognized by your immune cells, like your neutrophils and macrophages. They will again come and they will try to destroy these fungal hyphae. They will again try to destroy these fungal hyphae. Again, now what is the problem here? Patients who are impaired, that means their immune system is impaired by glucocorticoids, by neutropenia, by hyperglycemia, and by iron overload, they are not able to fight this. So along with that, when there is an iron overload, that means there is increase of iron present in your body, what will that do? It will favor the growth of this fungal hyphae. It will favor the growth of this fungal hyphae. So basically, along with the neutrophils not able to kill these fungal hyphae, the iron is helping in the faster growth of this hyphae. So from here, it progresses into the hyphae because of all these problems. And from there, what is the final outcome once these hyphae start growing? Their major property is angioinvasion. They show angioinvasion. Now, what is that? It's nothing but these fungal hyphae has the ability to invade into your blood vessels and cause damage. What do? As soon as they get inside your blood vessels, they will cause hemorrhage. They will cause thrombosis. And finally, the blood flow to different organs, different tissues are blocked out. So there will be infarction resulting in necrosis of the tissue. The tissue will die out. Along with that, all these things are happening at a specific point. For example, inside your nasal cavity, inside your sinus, or within your lung. But since the hyphae has gained entry into your blood vessel, now there is a big problem that is awaiting us. That is, these will get traversed to different or disseminated to different parts of your body. That is where the major problem comes. The fungal hyphae, once they gain entry into your blood vessel, they will get disseminated to different organs. Which are organs? The organs that are highly supplied with your blood vessels or high blood supply. That is your brain. Okay, your kidney, your heart, your spleen. All the major organs will get affected. And one by one, there will be organ failure, resulting in multi-organ failure, finally resulting in death of the patient. Okay, and this doesn't happen over months. This is a very fast progressing disease. So that is why always they say the treatment plan or the whatever we do, it should be aggressive in nature. We should not delay anything because it is very fast moving fungal infection. Okay, so I hope the pathogenesis is clear. So now we know what is happening and how it attacks our system and what all cells play a role. Just Neutrophils, why I talked about neutrophils, because they play the major role. There are many other immune cells which take part in removing this fungi, but the primary role is played by your neutrophils. Okay, so that is your pathogenesis. Now coming to different types of your mucormycosis. We'll see all the different types of mucormycosis that has been classified. Okay, now what are these? These are your, the first and the most important one for from dental point of view, it is our rhinocerebral mucormycosis. This rhinocerebral mucormycosis is now renamed as rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis, or it is in short form, they will put it as ROCM, rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. Why? Infection starts in the nose, then it moves into your sinus, from there into your ethmoid bone, and from there directly into your brain. Okay, so that is the pathway, because easy pathway for it to spread. And that is why the term is now put rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. Now, what is this? This is an infection in the sinus that spreads to the brain. Okay, very important. Most common in people with uncontrolled diabetes and people who have had kidney transplant. Okay, now how does the pathogenesis, like what we studied, spores gain entry into your nasal passage. They'll mature or germinate into the hyphae, and they will gain entry into your blood vessel, angioinvasion, causing thrombosis, infarction, and finally necrosis of the tissue. Now, what are the clinical features that we should look out for? One-sided facial swelling, headache. The patient will come with headache, nasal or sinus congestion. As it progresses a lot more, the patient will come with a black lesion on the nasal bridge or upper inside of the mouth, basically in the palatal region. The patient will come with a black ulcer. Okay, so that is one. And some kind of serosagnus, nasal discharge plus fever. Mostly this discharge will be blackish, bloody in color. So these are the important clinical features. Now from the sinus, once it moves into the orbital region, it will start showing some ophthalmic features like ptosis, proptosis, loss of your extra ocular muscle function, and vision disturbances. Okay, so these are the signs as it moves into your orbital region. And a classical sign from a dental point of view is, like I said, a necrotic lesion on the hard palate or the nasal turbinate. Okay, that is your nasal concave. Then drainage of black pus from eyes are useful diagnostic signs for rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, so that gives you a basic idea about rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, this is very important from a dental point of view, because most of us will come across this type of mucormycosis. Now moving on to the next type, that is your pulmonary mucormycosis. Now pulmonary mucormycosis, again, it is the most common type of mucormycosis in people with cancer and in people who have had an organ transplant or a stem cell transplant. This is again followed by inhalation of your spores, gains entry into your lung parenchyma, resulting in ischemic necrosis and massive tissue destruction. Okay, what are the clinical features? The patient will present with fever, cough, chest pain, and shortness of breath. Okay, that is your pulmonary mucormycosis. Then you have gastrointestinal mucormycosis. More common among young children than adults, especially premature and low birth weight infants, less than 1 month of age. These patients would have had some kind of antibiotics, surgery, or medication, which can lower their body's ability to fight infection. Okay, so remember this, mucormycosis is an opportunistic fungal infection. Okay, that means it is waiting for your immune system to low down or to come down so that it can start attacking our body. Okay, what are the clinical features? Abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, and gastrointestinal bleeding. Now coming to cutaneous type of mucormycosis. This, the fungi gains entry into your body through a cut in your skin, or some kind of trauma that has occurred in your skin, or after surgery, or after some kind of burns. Okay, what are the clinical features that you see in this? The most common type of clinical features is blisters or ulcer on the skin, black discoloration of the affected areas, swelling and pain in the site. And it progresses to black ashes. Again, black discoloration you will see on your skin. Okay, so that is cutaneous mucormycosis. Then moving on to your last type, that is your disseminated mucormycosis. This occurs when through the blood, the infection or the fungi travels to different organs in your body. And like I said, the most commonly affected ones are your brain, spleen, heart, and skin. So when it spreads through your blood to different parts of the body, that is known as disseminated mucormycosis. So with this, we have seen all types of mucormycosis. Okay, and for us, from dental point of view, I feel we will be most commonly associated with rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, now when to start suspecting? As a clinician, as a general practitioner, when do you start suspecting? When patient comes to you with complaint of sinusitis, when patient starts complaining with sinusitis, one sign that should start triggering a thinking in your mind. Okay, one-sided facial pain, swelling, numbness. Patient will come with sudden toothache, loosening of teeth, and jaw pain. And as it progresses a lot more, it gets more easier because then you have black discoloration of the palate and sometimes over the bridge of your nose. And as it moves to the orbital region, you will have signs like ptosis, proptosis, blurring visions, and everything will start appearing. Okay, so these are the time when you should start thinking about or start even questioning what this is. Okay, now why this whole seminar was started now is because of this COVID situation. So why is there an increased occurrence of mucormycosis in COVID-19 patient? Why? Why should we start thinking about this all of a sudden now as dentists? Why should we be more careful? This is because of the alteration in the patient's immune system. Those patients who are COVID positive, their immune system has been hampered, has been altered. Why? What are the reasons? First one is prolonged usage of steroids and patients being on ventilator for a very long time. This weakens your immune system. Then once patients develop this, they can develop some secondary bacterial fungal infections. What do the doctors do? They will start giving them broad spectrum antibiotics and some kind of antifungal drugs. Now, the problem with this is that when you give broad spectrum antibiotic for a longer period of time, some antifungals for a longer period of time, they will kill out all the pathogenic microorganisms. Along with that, what will happen is that they will take out your normal common cells or normal protective bacteria, they will wipe it out. Common antifungal, the problem is, the most commonly used antifungal are useless against mucormycosis, or they actually do not have any effect against mucormycosis. So what does common antifungals do? They will take out all other fungal infections in your body. Now the mucormycosis alone, without any competition, ready to take on your body alone. Before, it was fighting with the other fungi to take a position in your body to affect you. But now everything is being wiped out by the doctors giving common antifungal, which they had to give because of some fungal infection. Now what it has helped is that it will help to the mucormycosis to thrive at without any competition. Okay, so it is again aiding in one way to the more faster spread of mucormycosis. Along with all these problems, if the patient has all those risk factors that we talked about, then the outcome is going to be fatal. Then the outcome is going to be fatal because now he is more compromised. He is having neutropenia, or he is having some kind of diabetic ketoacidosis or iron overload in his body, which will actually aid in the spread and faster dissemination of the fungi in your body. Okay, that is why we are now have to be worried why there is an increased occurrence of mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients. Okay. Okay, moving on to the next slide. So what is the pathogenesis associated with COVID associated mucormycosis? What is happening? Almost similar pathogenesis. Basically, everything will come down to your neutrophil function. So basically, patients with COVID infection, those who have risk factors like hyperglycemia and those who are on corticosteroids and immunosuppressants, what happens is that the corticosteroids and immunosuppressants, they will impair your neutrophil function, migration, ingestion, and phagolysosome fusion. All of this is important in killing of the fungi. When there is an increased hyperglycemia, when the patient is uncontrolled diabetic, again, what happens is that from a molecular level, there is a protein known as glucose-regulated protein 78, which is expressed on the endothelial cells in your body. Now, what happens that with hyperglycemia, the expression of these receptors is increased. And what these receptors, they do is that they aid in much faster binding to the fungal hyphae so that this fungal hyphae can actually invade into the blood vessels at a much faster rate. Okay, along with that, again, hyperglycemia will cause PMN dysfunction, impaired chemotaxis. The neutrophil is not able to reach the fungi. Chemotaxis is the chemical gradient movement of your cell, especially your neutrophils and macrophages, to the site of infection. Okay, certain chemicals are released which will guide these neutrophils to reach there. Now that is lost or that is impaired. So that is not happening. And defective killing by these cells, either oxygen dependent or oxygen independent killing, is not happening properly. So again, overall, what is happening? It is impairing your immunity. So that is what is happening in COVID patients, why they are affected, Okay. Now, as oral healthcare providers, what should we do? Like as a periodontist or as a general dentist, what role can we play? Because we are not going to treat these patients for mucormycosis as such. Our role as general practitioners or other specialists, when we come across these cases, what our duty is to screen, suspect, and refer for immediate advanced treatment. That is a role that we have to do. We have to make sure that the patient is provided the best care at the right time without any delay, which is very, very important in COVID patients and in case of mucormycosis. Because like I said, it is a relentless disease and spreads at a very faster rate. So what should we do as a clinician when we sit in our clinic and when we see patients? What should we think about before we refer the patient or before we start suspecting the patient? So we have to screen first. How do we screen? We have to take a COVID history of the patient. First important thing. So first thing you ask the patient when they come to your clinic, were they COVID positive or negative? Were they exposed to the virus or not? If yes, were they hospitalized? Very important, were they hospitalized? If they were hospitalized, what were the treatments that were given to them? Were they given steroids? Were they given any kind of broad spectrum antibiotics? Or were they given any antifungal drugs? That is first and foremost thing that you should ask them. Second, look for your predisposing or your risk factors. Whether the patient is diabetic. If diabetic, is he uncontrolled? How do you get that? You cannot do it on a normal blood glucose levels. Go for an HbA1c. Ask whether the patient is on any immunosuppressive drugs. Any history of blood malignancy, very important, especially blood malignancies, and any post-transplant history. Again, so once you correlate these two together, and you get many positive findings from this, then you move on to the next level of clinical examination. So you have taken a history, you have taken a history of predisposing factors. Once that is done, and if you are coming positive in those, you move to intraoral clinical presentation of the patient. Mobility of teeth without no other cause, no periodontal cause, but sudden mobility of the teeth. Draining sinuses, ulcers and discoloration, especially blackish discoloration. Non-healing wounds, exposed bones. Again, it should start ringing bell. Extraoral clinical presentation, tenderness in the sinus region. So do not always eliminate patients by saying that it's just bacterial sinusitis. No, at this time, in this condition or era where we are living in COVID times, we have to be extra cautious. Tenderness of the sinus region, blocked nose, blackish bloody discharge from your nose, ulcers, facial swelling, periorbital swelling, patient coming with headache and fever. Once you correlate all this, and if you start, so your screening is done now, and now you are suspecting it, as a general practitioner, as any other specialist in dentistry, your role is now immediately to take a consult. Immediately call your maxillofacial friend or call your maxillofacial colleague who's working with you. Give them the history. Tell them that, see, I've come out with all these findings. I suspect, especially in India, you should start suspecting because there are high number of cases. Where I come from, in last 5 to 6 years, we have not even reported a single case of mucormycosis in Seychelles. So we are at a much, safer area. But still, even when I do patients now in my clinic and my surgery, I always do a check of this, of the screening system, because it's very important. You cannot compromise your patient. The most important thing as a clinician, as a doctor, as a dentist, that you have to do is make sure that your patient is safe. That from your hands, whatever you can do best for the patient, you do that. Okay, so take this history, and once you correlate with your clinical findings, refer immediately for an advanced opinion and treatment, because the diagnosis comes with a direct microscopy. So we cannot make a final diagnosis. We can come to a provisional diagnosis. And then it is the role of an oromaxillofacial surgeon to do further analysis, further clinical examination, and further blood profiles, further histology, to get a final diagnosis and start an aggressive treatment plan for these patients. So now, with this in mind, I hope you have got a clear idea about what mucormycosis is, what are its types, what is the pathogenesis, and as a clinician, what you should do. Now, with this, I would like to say thank you to everybody. But before I conclude, I would like to say, you should be always aware of the disease and its progress. Do not miss warning signs and symptoms. Always keep a high index of clinical suspicion. And like I said, do not overrule normal sinusitis as bacterial sinusitis, especially in context to immunosuppressors and COVID-19 patients. And do not hesitate to seek consult and start aggressive intervention. Why I'm saying all this is because there is not enough diagnostic tools now. To come to a diagnosis of mucormycosis, it is challenging. And there are a lot of predisposing factors now there out in the environment, which is favoring this. So we should always keep this in mind and do not lose your crucial time by hesitating to initiate treatment. From our point of view, it is to initiate a consult. Give a suspect and initiate a consult. Okay, so this is the references that I've used. You have a lot of references now online and a lot of latest articles that have come on. So you can go online, and most of them are actually free in PubMed. So you can go through the latest article and come out with different cases and even its pathogenesis and the latest recent advances in management of this. Okay, thank you so much. I now give the floor to Dr. Pravish so that he can move on with the diagnostic techniques and the treatment plan for mucormycosis. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. That was an extensive presentation, and you have educated all of us very well on this topic. Now, the next speaker is Dr. Pravish V. He is MDS in oral medicine, oral and maxillofacial surgery. In 2012, AIPG rank was 104 and COMEDCARE rank was 21. Sir has done his BDS from JSS Dental College, Mysore, and MDS from GDC, Kozhikode. Sir has been a speaker for various dental, oral and maxillofacial surgery forums. So now, sir, I hand over the stage to you.
Thank you, doctor, for your introduction, and it was well covered, Dr. Jerry. You have extensively covered how the disease progresses, and it is very important for us, being a dentist and a health worker, we should be knowing what is this disease and how it is going to progress and what are all the treatment modalities available for the disease. And I've seen some of these people thinking in a different way, saying that I'm not actually going to treat such people. So should I learn more about mucormycosis? It's not about treating alone. See, if you know about the condition, if you know about the mortality and morbidity associated with it, it will help you to educate, counsel, and refer the patient at the earliest. You know, the first person whom you might be the first person who is actually going to diagnose that the patient is having a mucormycosis, and you might be the person who is actually going to save life of that person. So it is very important. And my topic will be, or my presentation will be, mostly on how the clinical progress of rhino-orbital mucormycosis is going to take place. And I'll tell you about how the clinical progression is, and this will help you in identifying what kind of symptoms and signs you have to look for. And finally, I would be adding a word on how the entire disease is going to be treated. Okay, so topic is on COVID-associated mucormycosis. So as Dr. Jerry had already said, this disease was there. It was there since long. It was there since, you know, the unhygienic days long back, when there was the hygiene was poor, when the diabetes mellitus incidence was more. So the immunocompromised conditions were more. All those times we used to get mucormycosis, but it was very, very, very rare. And present scenario, what is being changed? The COVID has come, the immunity is being suppressed like anything, and patients are on masks, they are on ventilators, they are having issues with the fungal spore being built up in their orofacial region. So that is going to cause mucormycosis. So I'll just add a few things on how it is. You have the spores everywhere, and it can be in a bread mold, mud, cow dung, or any unhygienic surface, and it can be ingested or it can be breathed in. And when it is being breathed in, it is obvious that it's going to get stuck somewhere in the nose, in the sinus, and it sometimes may go into the lung. So what was the problem if you ingest or if you are going to inhale these spores? In a normal person, we are also inhaling spores, but you know, normally, as Dr. Jerry had explained, our body fights it off. You know, our body fights it off, and when the normal commensals are there, then other fungal organisms are there. This particular fungus won't get enough iron or enough nutrients to, you know, grow. So normally, it, you know, spores enters and it goes off like that. Nothing happens, but in COVID, it may get affected. The fungus growth might take place. And what happens when it grows? It grows angio-invasively. So it has some filaments which is going to invade the blood vessels, and it is going to form a clot. And when clot is formed, it is like osteoradionecrosis and all, you know, that area will lose its blood supply. So it is like a necrotic piece of bone will develop, or a necrotic piece of soft tissue is going to develop. So that is what is basically going to happen, and the fungus is going to keep on growing. Okay, so the association of COVID-19 with mucormycosis can be concomitant. You know, you will be still having COVID-19 and having a mucormycosis, or it can be sequential, weeks or months after recovery. I get queries like, you know, sir, when can this happen? Say after 1 week or 2 weeks or after months, it can happen anytime. You know, after COVID, it takes a lot of time. See, your immunity is like a currency. You have spent the currency to prevent, or you have to fight the COVID disease. So you have spent the currencies. So next, your currencies has to build up, or your immunities has to build up to fight against another disease. So it will take time. So in meantime, if you are getting infected by mucormycosis, it may be weeks or months after it, there are chances that it can lead to a full-fledged infection. So predisposing factors were discussed very well by Dr. Jerry. So we should be knowing these predisposing factors. Along with that, the CDC, the they had released last year itself, 2020 itself, they had released certain other association. There can be adhesive bandages which are tied onto your nose when you have when you have a Ryle's tube, or to the mouth when you have a tube which is going to be connected to the ventilator machine. So these adhesive bandages sometimes remain there for a few days or weeks. Also, there can be a fungal mold in that. Then hospital bed sheets. You know, you cannot possibly change bed sheets of a bedridden patient every day. You cannot lift them up, move it around. So there can be problem with